The computer in a Tesla stores a lot more information about the battery and the other details of the vehicle than what is available to the user through the regular interface, even in service mode. A friend of mine has the required tool to connect to the OBD2 port on my 2015 Tesla Model S and the Scan My Tesla app to be able to extract this information, so I took him up on his offer to do just that.
I'm here in my car with someone who has a CAN bus reader. Is that what this is, right? Yeah.
OBD.
Sensor, and that's Bluetooth going to his phone, and he just scanned my car, and so now I have more details about it than I've known before, so I'm going to now go look at those stats.
I'll put a card above to a video that he made that outlines in greater detail all the features of the Scan My Tesla app and all the data that's available through it. In this video, I'm just going to highlight some of the key details about the status of my now 8.5-year-old Model S with 135,000 miles on it. The badging on my Model S is 85D, which means 85 kilowatt hour battery with dual motors. Tesla has since abandoned this nomenclature and instead, depending on the model, they have dual motor displayed or plaid, etc. Most people don't understand kilowatts or kilowatt hours, but most people do understand miles of range, so Tesla just gives the EPA rated range estimate, which is always a rough guess of what you'll actually get, because range depends on lots of factors and varies from drive to drive, and even moment to moment while you're driving, up and down hills, or wind speed and direction changes, etc. For example, we recently drove to Las Vegas in our Model S to pick up our new Model Y, which I made a whole video about, and I'll put a card above to that video. The main reason we decided to buy the Model Y was because Tesla offered an unprecedented opportunity to transfer our free unlimited supercharging over to a new Tesla, and the new Teslas supercharge far faster than our old Model S. This trip was an excellent opportunity to compare specific details of charging speeds. When we arrived at the Tesla showroom in Las Vegas, we plugged our Model S into the supercharger there, and it peaked very briefly at 130 kilowatts, and we charged it from 13% to 96%. That's an unusual charge, since typically we'll only charge enough to get to the next supercharger, but in this case, we were there longer than the charge took anyway, and we knew that we would be using a good chunk of that energy driving back to St. George, Utah that same evening. The average charge speed over that entire long charge was 41.9 kilowatts. However, a more typical charge from 16% to 81% has an average charge speed of 53.5 kilowatts. Compare that to our 2023 Model Y, where the highest supercharger speed I've seen is 261 kilowatts, and the average charge speed from 7 to 97% was 81.2 kilowatts.
260 kilowatts. I didn't know these cars. Oh, 261. This is my personal record. I have never seen it that high, which, granted, this car is really new. Right now only has 930 miles on the odometer, for instance. But wow, that's much higher than I expected, especially considering it is 33 degrees outside. Now, I had this on since we started driving at about 24% on the battery. And I had this routed to the supercharger for that long, so it conditioned the battery, but it conditioned it really well. Like, that was a really high spike. So the battery's warmed up, and then also, I guess, it's not concerned about the battery overheating from high energy coming into it because it's cold. And so that's really good. I'm curious to see what this will look like on future road trips as we continue to use the car.
We don't typically charge that long, so a slightly more realistic example is we charged from 17% to 85%, and the average charge speed was 94.9 kilowatts. 85% is still higher than we typically charge it to while we're on road trips, so the average charge speed will easily remain well over 100 kilowatts most of the time on future road trips, at least on the V3 superchargers. For that reason, the Model Y is delivering on one of the biggest reasons why we moved free supercharging over to it, and that move will enable us to drive far more miles per day than we've been able to in our Model S. I will be showing more details on how our next road trips this summer play out in the Model Y, which we're planning for 2024, so stay tuned for those videos. Now let's get back to the beginning of the report and go through the key highlight statistics that have been accrued over the last 135,000 miles. If you want to know what the other stats on these pages mean that I don't talk about, then go watch the Scan My Tesla overview and a deep dive video that I'll link in the video description below. Distance shows the current odometer reading, which at the moment this scan occurred, it was at 134,998 miles. Full rated range shows how many miles of range my car would have if it was fully charged. When mine was new, it was 270 miles of rated range. As you can see here, it's currently calculating 249 miles of rated range, which means that I'm at 92.22% of the original range. Or conversely, I've lost 7.78% of the original rated range. Nominal full pack shows how much energy my battery can store when fully charged, and mine is at 71.9 kilowatt hours. Tesla has never been transparent about the specifics of battery pack and how much energy it can store, but back in 2016, a well-known Tesla hacker, Jason Hughes, found that the battery pack size was actually 81.5 kilowatt hours. On the energy buffer line, it shows that 4 kilowatt hours are held in reserve to protect the very top and bottom state of charge of the battery to avoid permanently damaging the battery. So the usable amount of energy in my Model S when it was new was likely 77.5 kilowatt hours. Since my battery now has a nominal full pack at 71.9 kilowatt hours, that means my battery has 92.77% of the original capacity. Or, looking at it the other way around, it has lost 7.22% of its storage capacity. Obviously, 7.22% is not the same as 7.78% range reduction I just mentioned above, but they are close, and I don't know the precise details of how these metrics are calculated. On the DC charge line, it shows my car has received 17,171 kilowatt hours of electricity from DC fast charging. But for me, while I've owned that, the DC charging is exclusively from superchargers. The cost of supercharging has increased through the years, but as a point of reference, at a flat 20 cents per kilowatt hour, this would have cost $3,434, or at 30 cents per kilowatt hour, $5,151, or at 40 cents per kilowatt hour, it would have cost $6,868, but was all free since this car has free unlimited supercharging. The AC charge line indicates the electricity from AC charging for my car is 28,512 kilowatt hours, which makes sense since we've primarily charged our car from AC electricity here at home when we're not on road trips. These stats are for the lifetime of the car, and we've purchased it with 63,000 miles on it. I have no idea what the prior owner's charging habits were. At 11 cents per kilowatt hour, which is about the price for electricity in Utah where we live, this would have cost $3,136. And at the average price for electricity in the United States of 19 cents per kilowatt hour, this charging could have cost $5,417. The regenerated line indicates how much power was generated while slowing the car down with regen braking, and this car has regenerated 21,032 kilowatt hours of electricity, which is much higher than I would have guessed. As a point of reference, in the video demo I have linked in the description below, that car has just over 100,000 miles and has regenerated 13,713 kilowatt hours of electricity. Two main things I can think of that we've done to increase this number is we try to start slowing down early enough that the regen braking has time to slow the car before the friction brakes are needed. Plus, keeping the car in a garage in the winter will help keep the battery warmer, which then allows stronger regen braking in the winter, or any other method of having the battery be warm while driving, such as charging right before departure, which is what we also try to do. Then also, we live in Utah and we drive through mountains regularly, so there's lots of regen braking holding the car back coming down the mountains. If you have any other thoughts around this number, feel free to share your insights in the comments below. Charge total shows the combined electricity that has been charged into the battery pack via DC or AC charging, plus regen braking, and for me that's a total of 66,712 kilowatt hours. Discharge cycle shows the equivalent amount of electricity that has been discharged from the battery pack over its lifetime, and for this car, that's 870 times the battery capacity. Conversely, the charge cycle shows the equivalent amount of electricity that has been charged into the battery pack at 928 times. I imagine the discrepancy between discharge and charge cycles is the efficiency losses, but if you know it's something else, chime in the comments below. There are additional metrics in these screenshots, so feel free to peruse them all you want, but in my recap, these are the highlights I wanted to cover. I really like data, and I wish Tesla would give us more data in the interface, such as the battery temperature and some of these lifetime stats, for instance. The battery temperature is available in service mode, so I'm glad it's available there, but that's annoyingly hidden and takes more time to access. These other lifetime stats give really interesting insights into the condition of the battery and would especially be helpful when shopping for a used Tesla. I will include a link in the video description to the Scan My Tesla website if you'd like more information about that. I hope it's been helpful to see these hard to access stats on my older Tesla with 135,000 miles on it. And if you have any comments or questions, post those in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.